Romans and chapter 10, and we shall consider and continue to consider this morning that section at the end of the 10th chapter that we thought we might get through on Wednesday evening, but we only got verses 16 and 17 done. So we'll read from verse 16 and then give special attention in our message this morning to verse 18 to verse 21. So reading together Romans chapter 10 from verse 16. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah saith, Lord, who hath believed our report? So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. But I say, have they not heard? Yes, verily, their sound went into all the earth, and their words unto the ends of the world. But I say, did not Israel know? First Moses saith, I will provoke you to jealousy by them that are no people, and by a foolish nation I will anger you. But Isaiah is very bold and saith, I was found of them that sought me not. I was made manifest unto them that asked not after me. But to Israel he saith, all day long I have stretched forth my hands unto a disobedient and gainsaying people. And so reads God's precious word to us. The main point in all of this, and most of the commentators that I read would agree with this, is that this section really is a confrontation against the disobedience and unbelief of Israel that was not just expressed in the time of Christ and the apostles, but even in the Old Testament. In fact, Paul here goes all the way back to Moses and to Isaiah to show that Israel's disobedience and Israel's unbelief and unwillingness to obey the word of God and obey the gospel was always the reality among the vast majority of the nation. And there are five, as we said last Wednesday evening, there are five times the word but appears, once verse 16 and then from verse 18 to verse 21 once each time. So on five occasions in this passage, Paul addresses what could be put forward as a possible reason, as a possible excuse, and one by one Paul disables or disengages these vain excuses, which are no excuse at all. And he shows that at the end of the day, what is at the root of the problem is simply disobedience and rejection of God, his word, and of his gospel, and subsequently of his Messiah. It wasn't just that generation who rejected the Messiah. It was every generation from the wilderness on who in the majority rejected the Messiah of God. And that's why Paul says in this section of Romans 9 through 11, and especially in chapter 11, that it is always the remnant, it is always the people that are taken out, which are counted as the faithful seed. And it is always the case. So we looked at the first but on Wednesday evening, and it was the but of gospel disobedience. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah saith, Lord, who hath believed the report? So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And we went into some detail on those two verses, so we won't recap. Just to say that what we did emphasize very much on Wednesday evening, unless the Lord of hosts had left us a remnant, we would have been made like unto Sodom and unto Gomorrah, as it says earlier on in chapter 9. And in verse 29, it says, and as Isaiah said before, except the Lord of Sabaoth had left us a seed, we had been as Sodom and been made like unto Gomorrah. So the but of gospel disobedience, God must change the disobedient heart into a heart of faith. Again, we think of Jeremiah, we think of Ezekiel, which emphasize this point. Continually and constantly, God reminds them that there's no hope in themselves. Ezekiel preaches to a valley of dry bones, but it's in the preaching of the word of God. Faith cometh by hearing, even to a valley of dry and dead bones. And as Ezekiel emphasizes, and they were very dry. There was no moisture. There was no hint of an ability in them to respond. All of the power and all of the life and all of the hope comes from the effectual preaching of God's word. We also made the point, and let's say this lastly, that not only is that true for the ungodly, but that is true for us as believers as well, isn't it? We come this morning, and again, as Psalm 78 reminds us, we come attentively to hear the word of God because we know it's in hearing that word preached, not because of the preacher, but because of God's promise, that that will give life. In fact, in Psalm 133, it tells us that there the blessing God commands, life that shall never end. The Lord Jesus Christ said, "He who hears my word, though he were dead, yet shall he live, and he who lives and believes shall never die." So we come this morning to receive fresh life from the word of God. As the Lord Jesus, when he raised that girl from the dead and he instructed the parents to give her some food, we come this morning as those who have been raised from the dead, and we need feeding. We need to be fed by the word of God. Give us this day our daily bread. It's not just about human bread, but about feeding on God's word. So enough for recap. We go on now to point two. The but of gospel hearing. The but of gospel hearing. But I say, and he puts forward the possible excuse. Have they not heard? Is it the problem that they just haven't heard this gospel? That they haven't clearly heard the word of God? Is that the difficulty? Is it that the information just has not come to them? If hearing and if faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God, is the problem just that they haven't been told? Is that the problem? Well, in the rest of verse 18, he answers, yes, verily, they have heard. Their sound, and that's the Septuagint translation of the Old Testament verse. The Masoretic text is their line. Their sound went into all the earth, and their words unto the ends of the world. So they have heard. And the scripture this is taken from is Psalm 19, which we sometimes sing before the message. Psalm 19 and verses 1 to 4. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork. And again, a number of the commentators, Charles Hodge and Haldane, definitely among them, would say that it's not that Paul is going back to this passage and showing that all the information we have in the gospel now was as clear back then, but the same principle applies. In other words, the knowledge they had in the Old Testament was sufficient. And even in creation, in Psalm 19, day unto day utter its speech. In other words, it never stops. I think it was Hodge who said, at the very existence of the sun, how can people look at the sun and not be confronted with the majesty of God? Just that. And even over this last week, in this country that rarely gets wetter than we've got the last week, how can people not glorify God for what we have had? verse 3, there is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. And here we have the Hebrew translation, or the English of the Hebrew, their line is gone out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them hath he set a tabernacle for the sun. There is no excuse. Let me read to you from Haldane and what he says. Excellent comment on this. He says this: the Son of the creation preaches to all nations the existence, the unity, the power, the wisdom, and the goodness of God. He speaks in a language all nations may understand. All nations indeed have departed from the doctrine thus preached. Again, this is just a doctrine that the creation preaches. But this results from the disaffection to the doctrine, and not from the obscurity of the language of the preacher. Did you get that? The reason why the nations have departed even from what they see in creation, it's not that they're accepting the God of creation humbly and just wanting more. What Haldane is saying is this: that they even depart from what they see. And the reason for this is from the disaffection. In other words, they don't want to know the truth. And not from the obscurity of the language of the preacher. And the preacher there is the creation. That's so true. It's not the problem in the information. The problem is in us. And that's why in Romans 1 and 2, Paul shows us that the knowledge that man has will not save him, but will only condemn him. And we see that in Romans 1 and then in chapters 2, verses 14 and 15. As I said before, Martin Lloyd-Jones is excellent on those verses. You want to listen to anybody that's really going to clarify Romans 2, 14 and 15, which verses have been misinterpreted. People often interpret those verses to mean that we don't need to preach the gospel to deepest, darkest, whatever, because there's enough information in man's conscience and enough information in creation to save man. That's not what the verses are saying. And Lloyd-Jones so clearly says that and explains that. So the problem is not with the information. The problem is not with the gospel. The problem is not with creation or with the gospel we have in the new covenant. The problem, as Haldane says, is with man's disaffection to the doctrine, or lack of love for the truth. Now, brothers and sisters, that's true of all of us, isn't it? The reason why so often I don't read my Bible is because even as a believer, I get disaffected because of my own sin. Never ceases to amaze me the grace of God to us. The God who does not give up, even though so often we do. So often we fail and don't even want to go on, and yet God remains faithful to his people. An illustration of this, and I never would have looked at this as an illustration, only there was a cross-reference in my Bible, so I'll admit that openly. But when Ahab was looking for Elijah, Obadiah is looking for him. Ahab goes one way and sends Obadiah another way in 1 Kings chapter 18. And Obadiah says, there's not anywhere that the king has not sent to look for the prophet Elijah. And it's not the same with our God. There's not anywhere in this world where he is not sent with the gospel. the gospel of creation and the gospel of redemption. Turn in your Bibles to John chapter 12 and verse 19. John chapter 12 and verse 19. This is after the triumphal entry. And in verse 19, the Pharisees therefore said among themselves, "Perceive ye how ye prevail nothing? Behold, the world is gone after him." Even at this point, the message of Christ, the message of the gospel, had not only gone into all the world, but it had borne fruit in all the world. Not only had they all heard of Christ, but they were all coming to Christ. Verse 20, we see it. "And there were certain Greeks among them that came up to worship at the feast. The same came therefore to Philip, which was of Bethsaida of Galilee, and desired him, saying, 'Sir, we would see Jesus.'" They knew who they were looking for. This was not obscure. So the message of Christ, even at this point, had gone far beyond the borders of Israel, far beyond where Christ himself had been seen. Now, if that was true at this point, how much more true then in the times afterwards? And we see that again in Acts 17. Acts chapter 17, if you just come there for a moment. And verse 1, Now when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of the Jews. And Paul, as his manner was, went in unto them, and 3 Sabbath days reasoned with them out of the Scriptures, opening and alleging that Christ must needs have suffered and risen again from the dead, and that this Jesus whom I preach unto you is Christ. And some of them believed and consorted with Paul and Silas, and of the devout Greeks a great multitude, and of the chief women not a few. And then down to verse 6, "And when they had found them not, they drew Jason and certain brethren unto the rulers of the city, crying, 'These that have turned the world upside down are come hither also.'" And verse 8, "And they troubled the people and the rulers of the city when they heard these things." The gospel had not only affected every part of the known world, but the Jews were so moved by this doctrine that they sought to attack it wherever it raised its head. The strange part of it was, is the more they sought to attack the doctrine, the more that they sought to destroy and to quench this doctrine, the more it spread. Not the glory of our message. In fact, we possibly could say that one of the great problems in the Western world, especially Western Europe, is there's no opposition to the gospel. This is a problem. Now, we know there's underlying opposition, but no obvious outward, well, in relative terms to what we see here in Scripture. Because it is when the gospel is clearly not only preached, but also opposed, that is when the gospel thrives. We see it also in Colossians chapter 1 and verses 5 and 6. Colossians chapter 1, verse 5 and 6. "For the hope which is laid up for you in heaven, whereof ye heard before in the word of the truth of the gospel, which has come unto you as it is in all the world, and bringeth forth fruit as it doth also in you, since the day ye heard of it and knew the grace of God in truth." And also in verse 23, "If ye continue in the faith, grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel which ye have heard, and which was preached to every creature which is under heaven, whereof I, Paul, am made a minister. William Hendrickson, in his commentary, says this, and he quotes Justin Martyr in the middle of the second century, who wrote this: "There is no people, Greek or barbarian, or of any other race, by whatever appellation or manners they may be distinguished, however ignorant of arts or agriculture, whether they dwell in tents or wander about in covered wagons, among whom prayers and thanksgivings are not offered in the name of the crucified Jesus to the Father and Creator of all things." What Martyr says is this: it doesn't matter what part or place of the world people come from, they are seeking God in the name of Jesus Christ. And this was the middle of the second century, just 100 years after the life and death of Christ. And then, about 200 AD, Tertullian says this: "We are but of yesterday, and yet we have already filled your cities, islands, camps, your palace, senate, and forum. We have left you only your temples." What a statement of victory for the Christian gospel. The worst thing that happened to the Christian faith was when it was accepted by Rome. It's when it was opposed that it triumphed. The worst thing that ever could have happened was when Christianity became accepted and given legal status by the Roman system. And that's when everybody who wasn't really a Christian pretended to be Christians. So, is the problem the hearing? Well, we've clearly shown that's not the problem. Clearly, that's not the difficulty. As Paul says, hearing is not the issue, because their sound went into all the earth, verse 18 says, and their words unto the ends of the world. And I would say, to be honest, just because we don't know of evidence even outside of the Roman world, that's not to say that the gospel didn't even go outside the Roman world to some degree. We don't know for sure, but we certainly cannot say that it didn't, just because we don't have direct evidence of that fact. But then he goes on in verse 19 to deal with the issue of knowledge. Now, if it's a fact that they did hear, did they just not understand, as some, I think some translations say that? Did they not understand? I think Hendrickson, that's how he translates this verse. Did not Israel understand? In other words, they heard the message, but they just didn't get it. Is or was that the problem? Well, again, he appeals to Moses here in response. First, Moses saith, "I will provoke you to jealousy by them that are no people, and by a foolish nation I will anger you." God clearly in his response is saying the problem is not lack of understanding, but the problem is an unwillingness. And in fact, if you go, we have to go back to the passage that deals with this, or that Paul quotes from. It's in Deuteronomy chapter 32. And there's a whole section here that's worth looking at. This is the song of Moses in Deuteronomy chapter 32. And in verse 6 of his song, he puts forward a question: "Do ye thus requite the Lord? Or do you repay the Lord?" In other words, do you give back to him in like manner that he has given to you? He says, "O foolish people and unwise, is not he thy father that had bought thee? Had he not made thee and established thee? Look at all that God has done for you, Moses is saying. And even at this time, in the time of Moses, this God who had bought them and made them and established them, they were not repaying him, or they were not requiting him with that love that he had shown to them. Again, brethren, that is true of us, isn't it? And every time we do not respond to God in like manner that he has dealt with us, we are foolish and unwise as they were. In verse 7 of Deuteronomy 32, Moses says, there's abundant knowledge. Remember the days of old. Consider the years of many generations. Ask thy father, and he will show thee, thy elders, and they will tell thee. In other words, if you lack knowledge, if you lack understanding of why you should respond to God in this way, Well, go and get the knowledge. And what Moses is saying is there's wells of knowledge, many generations, by father, by elders, they'll all tell you. This reminds us of the responsibility we have as parents, doesn't it? Of communicating to our children so that they might have no excuse. So that we do whatever we can. Because as parents, it is our responsibility with our children to teach them and to discipline them. And then in verses 8 to 14, there's abundant history. When the Most High divided to the nations their inheritance, when he separated the sons of Adam, he set bounds of the people according to the number of the children of Israel. An amazing fact. He set the bounds of the people according to the number of the children of Israel. God dealt with the whole world in the context of his people. That's exactly what Paul says in Ephesians, isn't it? He is the head over all things, but to the church, or for the church, for the benefit of the church. Why? Verse 9 tells us. For the Lord's portion. There's a lovely contrast here in metaphor. Because in verse 8, he's talking about the portion that he has given to each nation of the world with a view to Israel. And now he's saying the reason is for the Lord's portion is his people. That's God's portion. In all of creation, it's a wonderful picture. In the whole of creation, God has made heaven and earth so that he might have for himself an inheritance. And that inheritance is his people. You as a believer in Christ is the very reason why God created the universe. That's what this verse tells us. Jacob is the lot of his inheritance. And in verse 10, how he dealt with him. He found him in a desert, in a waste, howling wilderness. He led him about, he instructed him, he kept him as the apple of his eye, as an eagle stirreth up her nest and fluttereth over her young, spreadeth abroad her wings, taketh them, beareth them on her wings. So the Lord alone did lead him, and there was no strange God with him. He made him ride on the high places of the earth, that he might eat the increase of the fields, and he made him to suck honey out of the rock, and oil out of the flinty rock, butter of kine and milk of sheep, with fat of lambs, rams of bread of the breed of Bashan, and goats with the fat of kidneys of wheat, and thou didst drink the pure blood of the grape. This is all that God done for his people. But then in verse 15 to 18 we see the response. But Jeshurun, and Jeshurun is a name for Israel. It's a name of devotion. It's a name, it's like a It's a name that a husband and a wife would give each other, a devoted name. But this one that God so dealt with in love and kindness, but Yeshua waxed fat and kicked. Thou art waxing fat, thou art grown thick, thou art covered with fatness. Then he forsook God, which made him, and lightly esteemed. The word lightly esteemed, just to deal in a to scorn the rock of his salvation. They provoked him to jealousy with strange gods. With abominations provoked they to him to anger. They sacrificed unto devils, not to God, to gods whom they knew not, to new gods that came newly up. There's a phrase. Any new fangled god that raised its head, they worship. And the very God that made them and bought them and delivered them, they rejected. And again, this shows the tendency that's in all our natures. We all tend to whatever level and whatever degree to walk away from the true God and to worship the God of our own imagination. Whatever new fangled God we can think of, we will worship. And I have no doubt this is the reason why the evangelical church in the world today is in such a mess. Because we find it impossible just to stick to this God. We really do, even as believers. It says in verse 8, and of the rock that begat thee, thou art unmindful. In other words, what he's saying, you don't even think about God. He doesn't even enter into your mind, and you've forgotten God that formed thee. Then in verses 19 to 21, which leads us into verse 21, which is the verse that Paul quotes. When the Lord saw it, he abhorred them because of the provoking of his sons and of his daughters. And he said, I will hide my face from them. I will see what their end shall be, for they are a very froward generation, children in whom is no faith. Notice here, God says the problem is not lack of knowledge. It's lack of faith. They didn't trust God. Didn't believe in God. That's the problem. So as back in Romans 10, the problem is not lack of knowledge. It's not lack of hearing. It's lack of faith. Verse 21, they have moved me to jealousy with that which is not God. They have provoked me to anger with their vanities, their empty things. And God says in his perfect justice, I will move them to jealousy with those which are not a people. Hendrickson says here, he says back in Romans 10 on this verse, a non-nation. I will move them to jealousy with those which are a non-nation. I will provoke them to anger with a foolish, or as we said, a non-nation. And again, most of the commentators make this point that the introduction of the Gentiles was always predicted right from the start. So it never should have been a surprise. You see, the Jews lived in this sort of ignorant state, not only of the true God, but but of the consequences of rejecting the true God. All the way through the Old Testament, we see this principle that God was going, and Isaiah says, I will speak to you through a people of a strange tongue. Constantly telling them that if they did not obey the Lord, they would be removed, and another, a non-nation or a foolish people, they would be brought in as a punishment for their rejection. So they had abundant knowledge, abundant history, but absolute apostasy, and then absolute abhorrence by the Lord. So, the problem was not hearing. The problem was not knowing. But then the fourth but in verse 20, and we'll finish briefly on these. But Isaiah is very bold and saith, I was found of them that sought me not. I was made manifest unto them that asked not after me. And one commentator makes the point, I forget which one, makes this point. He says, if Moses was in any way unclear, Isaiah is abundantly clear. If Moses is not clear enough in his statement, and the same commentator says this is why Isaiah is not very popular among the Jews, because of how clear Isaiah is on this. It's not just Isaiah 53 that's unpopular. Much of Isaiah is unpopular because it shows this principle of God rejecting the nation and bringing in the Gentiles. And this is from Isaiah 65. And you see, if you turn back again, we'll be brief as we close now, but in Isaiah 65, we read these words. I am sought of them that ask not for me. I am found of them that sought me not. What does this do to free will? What does that do to free will? I am found of them that sought me not. I am sought of them that ask not for me. No seeking. It's not that as people, again going back to the Romans 2 passage, it's not that there's people out in the world just waiting to hear the gospel, you know, just longing to hear the gospel. No, not at all. That's not the point. What God is saying here is he makes himself known to people who never wanted to look for him, who never saw him, who never asked for him. But then with Israel, verse 2, I have spread out my hands all the day unto a rebellious people. And again, free will again is shown. And again, the only emphasis of free will to the Jews is that they chose constantly to be rebellious and to walk in a way, verse 2, that was not good after their own what? Thoughts. A people that provoketh me to anger continually, verse 3, to my face, that sacrificeth in gardens and burneth incense upon the altars of brick, which remain among the graves and lodge in the monuments, which eat swine's flesh and broth of abominable things is in their vessels. No wonder the Jews don't like Isaiah, which say, stand by thyself, come not near to me, for I am holier than thou. This is the Pharisees of Christ's day. These are a smoke in my nose, a fire that burneth all the day. Behold, it is written before me, I will not keep silence. And they're reminded of Psalm 50 in this sense. Our God will surely come, keep silence, will not he, but will recompense, even recompense into their bosom. Your iniquities and the iniquities of your fathers together, saith the Lord, which have burned incense upon the mountains and blasphemed me upon the hills. Therefore will I measure their former work into their bosom. But then in verse 8, wonderful verses, and we close with these and then make one final reference back to Romans 10. Thus saith the Lord, as the new wine is found in the cluster, and one saith, destroy it not, for a blessing is in it, so will I do for my servants' sake, that I may not destroy them all. Again, the remnant. Look at verse 9. And I will bring forth a seed out of Jacob, out of Judah, an inheritance of my mountains, and mine elect shall inherit it, and my servants shall dwell there. And Sharon shall be a fold of flocks, and the valley of Achor a place for the herds to lie down in, for my people that have sought me. But ye are they that forsake the Lord, that people that forget my holy mountain, that prepare a table for that troop, and that furnish the drink offering unto that number. And it goes on, we could read on there up to verse 16, but we'll leave it at that. Wonderful grace of God. Contrast here in verses 20 and 21 as we close with the Gentiles. In verse 20, I was found of them that sought me not, the Gentiles. I was made manifest unto them that asked not after me, but to Israel he saith, again back in Isaiah 65, all day long I have stretched forth my hands unto a disobedient and gainsaying people. And can I say, just in closing, a point of application? We are to be like God in this. We are to continue to bring the gospel to people who refuse to hear. To a nation, our nation, refuses to hear. We are tempted to give up. I've seen so many give up over the years, who can go on with evangelism thinking that it's going to result in some, they're going to see people getting saved. Then after a while, this is not working. And God says, all day long, I have stretched forth my hands unto a disobedient and contrary, what the margin says, a gainsaying or contrary people. We are to remain faithful in our gospel witness, for that brings glory to God, that honors his name and glorifies his gospel. But they have not all obeyed the gospel, verse 16. For Isaiah saith, Lord, who hath believed the report? So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. But I say, have they not heard? Yes, verily, their sound went into all the earth, and their words unto the ends of the world. But I say, did not Israel know? First Moses saith, I will provoke you to jealousy by them that are no people, and by a foolish nation I will anger you. But Isaiah is very bold, and saith, I was found of them that sought me not. I was made manifest unto them that asked not after me. But to Israel he saith, all day long I have stretched forth my hands unto a disobedient and gainsaying people. May God bless his word to our soul.